I thought, man, that was, I still remember it. It startled me. I thought, well, I didn't know they'd done that when they're sanctified, but anyway, he did. So I was, you know, I watched those things. That was just a minor thing. I overlooked that and went on and on. And I've heard these preachers that said I had trouble with a certain pastor in a revival, and I just started to just beat him all to pieces because of something he'd done or said. You know, I mean, that's sanctification. You'll beat the devil out of him, I guess. You ever? But anyway, I transferred my license over. I passed the test, and I had two licenses then. I was in good shape. I had the Church of God license in good standing with them, and I had a Assembly of God license in my hand. I wanted to get the Assembly of God license first before I let go of my Church of God license. So when I got it in my hand, when I knew I had it, well, I called the Church of God parsonage to tell my pastor that I was even changed membership. I joined the Assembly of God and got my license with them, and that I wouldn't be back over there as a member. And I remember what he told me. He said, "Brother, I think you're making a mistake," when I called him on the phone, you know. And at that time, he's trying to take that church out and make it independent. I didn't know that. But he was undermining the church he was in. But he said, "I think you're making a mistake." All the time, this fussing and carrying on, you know. And so I got my license, joined the Assembly of God. The church I joined, they was shouting all over the place, rejoicing. Good spirit there. I thought, well, I'm going to launch off from here. And they told me, said, it won't be like it was in the Church of God. The minister told me that when I was taking my test, going into the Assembly of God. He said, one of them said, it won't be now, Brother Miller, it won't be like it was in the Church of God. And I might not have realized altogether what he meant, but I found out that there was more jealousy in the Assembly of God, because in the Church of God, they appointed you. They appointed a minister for 2 years. And if anybody interfered, another minister come around, he could come in and visit. They'd hug your neck, because they knew if you tried anything about taking their church or getting some of their members, that they could report you to the state overseer and have you kicked out, have your license taken away or anything else. So they was protected. The Assembly of God's not that way. They're independent. Each church is independent. Even though they belong to an organization, each church is locally controlled, makes their own government. The Church of God was like the government of the United States, locally. What'd you say?
Autonomous.
Okay, whatever. I don't know what that is. I did go to college, but I don't know what that word was. But anyway, they were locally controlled, where the Church of God was like the U.S. government, one central location, Cleveland, Tennessee. That's the headquarters. They sent out the messages and the laws, and everybody went by, supposed to. But I tried that, and that church there was on they're fixing to kick their pastor out, even though sometimes I've seen the shouting. Sometimes you can't always tell, at least I couldn't. It looked like they was at the height of spirituality, far as shouting, rejoicing, having a good time, and they were sitting on a volcano fixing, tear up And so I left that church and went out in the country, lived out in the country, and finally pastored Assembly of God Church. And if you want to see how good I was, they voted me in 100%. Man, they was desperate, wasn't they? Some little pastor, young boy was out there preaching, and he couldn't hardly take it or something. I don't know what it was. He left, and so I was going there for a few days, a few weeks, been going there, and I asked them to vote me in first time. I said, would I have a chance of being pastor? And they voted me in. I don't know if God wanted me in there or not. I'm not sure, but I suppose if you believe that you're a child of God and God is leading you, that all things work together. God has a lot. Sometimes you may go a long way around. You may wonder why things happen to you, but if you believe that God is having anything to do with your life, then He's guiding your steps. He's guiding you to something better. He's got you at heart. He's got He's interested in what you do and how you come out and where you end up. God is interested in all that. And so I tried that. I tried it and just, and it worked for a while, and I finally became dissatisfied, and I finally left them startled as I got up one Sunday morning and said, "I'm resigning the church. I won't be back till you get a pastor," because if I'd hung around, they probably never would have got nobody. There's that way. Probably, I just said, "I won't come back till you get a pastor." And so I left there and just went around here and there and trying to find God. I was dissatisfied. And just traveled here and there, visiting different places and churches and independent groups, and finally even went back to the Assembly of God. Then I would go to the Church of God, trying to go to two. And I tried to get my license with both of them even at one time. You know, I maybe mentioned that. Tried to get my license back with them. And I was trying to get the license, I told somebody, in the Assembly of God, so I could transfer it to the Church of God. Just all kind of complications there. And I run into dead end, so to speak. The more I'd try, the more I'd see that they didn't care about Jesus. All they cared about was their numbers and their organization. The more I tried, and then when I started coming around these people and hearing this evangelist, I tried to find out what was wrong with him, and hearing Nick Gruick some, a few things he said, and others would get up and say things. I couldn't hardly stand them at times, even argued with my wife and go home and argue with her and say, you know, how crazy it was, and so forth. That don't make sense. The scripture, it does not say that. And we'd argue over it, and it finally went on and on and on. But I want you to know that God didn't give up on me. Isn't that wonderful? God is any long-suffering? Any long-suffering in your life? Has he been long-suffering?
Yes.
Amen. If it wasn't, he would have cut us off long time ago. But his long-suffering is from generation to generation on those that fear his name. Amen. Those that love him, that want his will to be done. And amen, I pray, I know there was a period of time, and I hope it comes again. There was a period of time when all of a sudden the Lord stepped in my life. I can remember it at Chandler Assembly of God. I was still out wandering around like a fish out of water, so to speak, trying to find where I was supposed to be. They asked me to go preach. And so I went down to preach. I'd known a lot of people for years there in that church. And I went down to preach. And the Lord used me in a certain way in that service that brought, seemed like, all heaven into my life. I don't, if I could open the door, I'd do it again. I don't know what it was. Maybe you can explain it sometime. If you can, you can tell me what key to unlock. People say they're trying to get there. I don't know what I'd done, but I stepped into, they call it, what, twilight zone of God or what? I want you to know just that little thing I'd done. It scared me even to do it. But when I done it the first time in that service, my eyes opened up spiritually. God became so real to me, almost like Enoch. I was walking with God every day. I couldn't wait home. I was praying during the day on the job, and I couldn't wait until I got home to get along with God and pray and seek his face. Now, I want to get back to that time, whatever it was. I've got so much more truth now than I had then, but I want to find out what it was where I walked in the Spirit. I walked for days and days. I may have come a little bit at times, but I walked in the Spirit. Never had that in all my life. Thought I'd had great experiences, but I've never had that experience. Not again. Not like that, where I know that there's a place where you can sing in the Spirit. You can pray in the Spirit. Yeah. You can understand in the Spirit. Yeah. And God will lead and guide you. There is a place. I've been there. I want to get back. If God knows my heart, I'll do it. If I'll show me the key, I'll turn the key. I'll open the door, and I'll let him come in, whatever that was. I want to get back to that, along with some of the truth I received. Then I'll be able to be a better person and be able to help the body of Christ and help someone else. But I want you to know there is a place that we can get in God. I believe it's, I know it's there because I've been there. I'm not there like that, like I was. I don't know why. I don't know why. Have you ever been closer to God than you are right now? Maybe some of you have. Maybe you remember those times. But it went on for a long time, and I don't know what I'd done. Me and my wife weren't getting along too well at that time. I say too much about her. Some people say I say too much. She does know my name, by the way, in case y'all didn't know that. I left it the other night like she didn't even know my name when she was going with me. But she does know my name. I think, don't you? Oh, okay. Anyway. There is a place, I believe, that where we can hide with God. I want to get back to that.
Back to that.
I want, whatever it is, I don't know how to do it. Couldn't tell you. I cannot tell you there's a place I walked into, and I didn't do anything to deserve it. Didn't know near what I know right now about the truth. But there was a place I walked in, and God let me walk that way for, I forgot how many months, maybe two or three or four or five, I don't know, maybe. But it was the glory time, and it was, so I know it's there. I know there's a place in the Spirit where all day long, I was where the customers, they might have heard speaking in tongues first time. Some of those rich people might have started something painting on their homes. And so I don't know, because I'd get alone with God there while I was painting or working. The Spirit of God was walking with me, and I actually hurt in my body, aching. So for the time when I could just go home that afternoon and get in my bed, close the door and get in there and call on God. And sometimes, I don't know how many times I said, God, rather than go back to my family, can't I just go on to you? Amen. Felt so close. Amen. I know it's there. I know there's a place in the Spirit that we can get in. Now, that's where I want to be in this last day. Don't you?
Yes, sir.
I want to be there. I want it. You pray for me that I'll get it. Would you? Will you pray for me? There's a place where we can walk in the Spirit.
Yes.
We can talk in the Spirit. And it said if we are led of the Spirit, we are the children of God. As many as are led by the Spirit of God. And it said if you walk in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. That sounds like perfection, does it not? Is that right? If that's not perfection, then what is? There was times I believe I was close to perfection. Not long, But I believe I was getting there. I knew the scriptures. I'd been taught the scriptures on sanctification. Total sanctification. Totally committed to God. And I walk there. And I want to get back to there. I want to walk in the Spirit. Amen. Whatever it takes. I know a lot of cares of life keep people from doing that. They got worries and troubles and cares. But we can cast them on Jesus, can't we? Cast them on Jesus. I believe the Lord can get us back to that place. Didn't have this prepared. I had no idea I would say anything like this. And maybe it's for some benefit. Maybe someone here. Maybe someone is inspired maybe to do something for God. Maybe I am. Sometimes a sermon is to the minister. Do you know that? I preach sometimes such a sermon until I felt backslid after I got through preaching. Nobody knew it until, but after I had to get along with God after the service, after I'd went home or something. Did you know that? God would anoint and bless those. Sometimes He would tear me all to pieces. The sword cuts both ways. A two-edged sword, does it not? The Word of God cuts both ways. Amen. I believe that there is a place that we can get to. And I believe I'm going to have to get there if I'm going to be an effective witness for Jesus Christ. If I'm going to be able to stand in the lion's den or whatever, I'm going to have to get there. Did you know it? If those martyrs I read about, some of them standing there and the lions were coming out, they put them in the arena. It's been several years back into history, in the dark ages, I guess, and they were standing in the arena, and the lions were hungry. They would normally kill and destroy whatever was people they put in there. There was the Christians, a whole bunch of them. They put out in the arena, and they had the people in the stands like a football game to watch them being eaten alive by the lions. And those Christians at one time, they said, come on, we're the bread of Christ. Come on and gnaw on us. And those lions were afraid of them and backed off and wouldn't destroy them. They had to kill them some other way. The lions were afraid. Amen. When they seen such boldness of the Christians. I want to be that way, don't you? When it comes the time, and I believe it could come. I said, hanging around this group, you can get killed. You can get killed. There's a lot of easier ways. I tried to go back to, like I said, several places. That was a lot easier because they said you'll get out of all this if you believe in what we preach. Jesus is coming to take you out before that anything happens. Isn't that wonderful? But He kept cutting off every limb I'd hang on. I didn't have nothing but a naked tree. No limbs. That's right. Isn't it wonderful though to think? I might have thought, what in the world, when it's going on, how dirty and what is God trying to do to me? But later on, I seen how wonderful He cares that much for me. He cares. I want to be in the right thing, don't you? I want to be in the right place. I want to be in the right place. Amen. I want to be able, when the storm is going on and everything, the ship looked like it's going down, I want to be able to say, as Paul stepping out on the deck of that ship, sirs, be of good cheer, I believe God. Amen. I want to be able to stand in the storm and do that. If you'll do what I say, we'll all be saved. Isn't that wonderful? I want to do what the ministry says, don't you? I want to do what I hear from the Word of God. I want to do what Brother Watson says, and this brother here, Bagley, says, whatever they say. I'm the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I want to do that because I want to be saved. If you just do what I say, and I believe Jesus is saying that, if we'll do what He has said and what His ministry has said, and so if we'll do and obey, if we'll listen and obey, then I believe He's saying you will be saved. Don't nobody get off the ship. Everything's going to be fine. Amen. Hallelujah. I appreciate the Lord today. I feel His presence. I believe the Lord is here, don't you? Jesus is here. Amen. I appreciate Him. Hallelujah. Appreciate. Pray for us. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thanks the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you.